All right, well, we're continuing our series today in Isaiah, seeing salvation, Isaiah's prophecies of Emmanuel's arrival. I want to let you know at the end of our service, someone has a testimony they would like to share, so just encourage you not to run out right away or else you'll miss something that God has laid on Esty's heart to share with us. So we're excited to hear that at the end of our service today. You know, as I think about Christmas time and all that is happening this time of year, I'm reminded that we're all searching for something. We're all searching for something. And I would ask you, what is it that you are seeking? What is it that you are seeking? You don't have to tell me, but it could be, you know, that Christmas gift underneath the Christmas tree, the thing that you really want. And maybe as kids, you know, that's our focus at Christmas time. As we get older, I think we tend to lose that. I saw a commercial today where it starts out with this guy when he's like 5 years old, and he's 10 years old, and 15 years old, and like 21 years old. And every Christmas morning, he runs downstairs and he looks out the window to the driveway to see if there's that Lexus with the bow on it sitting in the driveway. And then, of course, when he's like 40-something, he kind of sleepily gets up and walks downstairs and rubbing the sleep out of his eyes. And you kind of see him stop, and I guess I'll go check. And he looks out the window, and there it is. Finally, after all these years, the Lexus with the bow on top. And his wife gives a kind of annoying look, and all those things like, what kind of lives do these people live? We're all searching for something. What is it that you seek? Maybe the perfect gift. Wouldn't it be great if there was a gift that had no expiration date, no sell-by date, no break-by date, no get-bored-by date? A gift that can meet all of our needs. Perhaps you're searching for a quick way to get rich. Or maybe just a simple life. And you say, man, these holidays are stressful. You know, why can't it just be simple like what you see in the movies? Or maybe your holiday life is kind of like too simple, and you're like, I wish I could have a little more stress and a little more things going on. And boy, I hear people talk about like, yeah, I went to 10 parties this week and I'm dead tired. And I think, boy, I'd like to go to just one. So, you know, maybe you come from different angles on this whole thing. Maybe you're searching for love, and maybe you're searching in all the wrong places. So we're all searching for something. I was thinking, what are some of the top searches on Google? And sure enough, just 3 days ago, Google came out with its top searches worldwide and in the United States in 2018. And I think it's rather interesting what the top searches are. Maybe not what you'd expect. The number one overall top search all over the globe, guess what it is? Top thing people typed into Google. Number one thing all over the world. Restaurants. Are you hungry? No, the World Cup. The World Cup, the number one thing. Now, you say, okay, yeah, you know what? The world's gone crazy with soccer, or as they call it, football. Number one top search in the United States. Our country's changing. The World Cup. The World Cup, the number one top search in the United States. Globally, World Cup, Avicii, Mac Miller, Stan Lee, and Black Panther. Top five things searched for. Top searches in the U.S., the World Cup, Hurricane Florence, Mac Miller, Kate Spade, and Anthony Bourdain. Some of the top how-to searches, I don't know about you, but you can go to Google and say, Google, how do I do this? And it'll call up a video, it'll call up something, and usually it's fairly correct. It hasn't failed me yet. So how-to, number one, how to vote. Well, yeah, well, that's pretty useful. How to register to vote. Okay, so people want to make a difference. But then you see where people get disenfranchised with number three, how to play Mega Millions. So maybe the vote didn't go your way. Maybe you don't trust in the government anymore, and so you're thinking, I'm going to play the lottery. Number four is how to buy Ripple. I'm not even sure what that is. How to turn off automatic updates. Well, that wouldn't be bad to know how to do. How to get the old Snapchat back. Okay. How to play Powerball. There we go. Another quick get rich quick scheme. How to buy Bitcoin, perhaps another get rich quick scheme. How to screen record, how to get the boogie down emoji. What? I don't even know what a boogie down emoji is. But that is the number 10 top how-to search in America. Okay? And also, what is? People that are hearing about things in the news and they're wondering, what is that? Number one, what is Bitcoin? Everybody wants to get on the Bitcoin train. You know, there could be repercussions for the end times. You know, you think about a one world economy and all that sort of thing, and we're never going to have a one world currency. Boy, Bitcoin would be really easy for somebody in power to control. What is racketeering? What is DACA? What is a government shutdown? Here's one that at least people must have heard this. Christians talking about this. What is Good Friday? That's the number five top how. What is search on Google? What is Prince Harry's last name? Does anybody know?
No.
That's what people were asking. What is Fortnite? What is a duck boat? That reminds us of that tragedy earlier in the year. What is a Yanni Laurel? You might remember that. And also, what is a nationalist? Number 10. So these are some of the top searches on Google. And it kind of gives us a window into what people are searching for, what they're asking about, what they're inquiring about. And so whether it's on Google or in life, we're all searching for something. And so I ask you, what is it that you seek? In Jesus' day, there were magi, wise men from the east, and they came seeking a king to worship. Their diligent search was guided by a star which led them to a home, a child with his mother, a king to fall down upon their knees and worship, a king worthy of great and costly gifts, a king whose birth brings exceedingly great joy to all who seek him. And the wise men, the magi, knew that great joy when they worshiped Jesus. In Isaiah's day, there was another king. 730 some years before the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem, in Isaiah's day, King Ahaz. And King Ahaz refused to seek the Lord. In Isaiah's prophecy, we read about him in chapter 7 through 9. King Ahaz refused to seek the Lord. The Lord said, "Ask for a sign that I will be with you, and I will give it to you to encourage you and the people." And King Ahaz said, "No. I will not put the Lord to the test." Well, he certainly did put the Lord to the test. He was a terrible, wicked king. He trusted in foreign powers rather than in the all-powerful God. He trusted in powerful men and worldly alliances. He sought wisdom and insight from dark occult practices rather than seeking guidance from the Lord and from his prophets. And all he found in his search was judgment and suffering and great calamity that he brought upon his own nation. You know, this week, December 21st, actually the date of the caroling party that we're having, is special because of what other reason, you know? December 21st. Yes, Debbie.
It's winter solstice day.
Winter solstice day?
Shortest day of the year.
Shortest day of the year, which means it's also the longest night.
Of the year.
The longest night of the year. And the longest night has become an organization actually focused on suicide awareness and something that we all should be aware of this time of year, and those struggling with depression. But December 21st marks the longest night of the year. And things in King Ahaz's day were like the beginning stages of a long, dark night for the people of God. Imagine, as in C.S. Lewis's The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, imagine a situation in which it is always winter, but never Christmas. Always winter, but never Christmas. That's how life in Judah may have felt in the 8th century B.C. But the promises of God bring joy in the morning. And Isaiah 9, the prophet looks forward through the darkness to the coming dawn of a new day. And in fact, in Isaiah 9, I hope you have your Bibles and you open up there. Isaiah 9, we're going to look at several scriptures today, but primarily Isaiah 9. As Isaiah looks through the years to the coming dawn, which will break through the darkness, he speaks of it with such assurance and confidence and certainty that he speaks of it in the past tense as if it has already taken place. And I'm reminded of a couple of things, that is what hope and that is what faith is, that we have such certainty, such assurance in the promises of God that we accept them today, even though in our own personal experience they are yet to be fulfilled. We accept those promises today as if they have already been fulfilled. So certain are we that God always keeps his promises. And I'm also reminded that God is not limited by time and space as we are. And so a promise made for God is a promise kept. And when we think about what is yet to come, we can talk about it in the past tense. So that's what Isaiah does here. Some of these things fulfilled in the coming of Christ at the first Christmas in Bethlehem. Others of these things yet to be fulfilled when Christ returns and establishes his 1,000-year millennial reign and even into the new earth and the new Jerusalem yet to come after that in all eternity. Isaiah 9, verse 1, there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali. We talked about that last week. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. It's there that Jesus begins his ministry and his preaching ministry, proclaiming that the kingdom of God has come. Repent and believe the good news. The people, verse 2, who walk in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in a land of deep darkness, on them light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. Here we talk about the borders of the nation expanding, its joy deepening. So it's widening, it's deepening in joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest. So there's a peacefulness here. People are living their lives, working lives, not having to worry about war anymore because of the victory. They are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden, the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot to the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. So we're talking about the reality behind that beautiful chorus, and I think it's John Lennon's song where the kids are all singing with heavenly voices, war is over. Okay, well, you know what? His vision of reality might not lead to that blessed reality, but God's vision of reality and Isaiah's vision for the future is just that. In fact, if you look back to Isaiah chapter 2, Isaiah begins with great hope, even though much of his message to the nation and to the kings is one of judgment. But there is great hope in Isaiah's prophecy, and that hope is centered in the servant, the Messiah, the Savior who is to come. But we read in Isaiah 2 in verse 4, he shall judge between the nations and shall decide disputes for many peoples. And then we read two phrases that are actually inscribed, written in stone outside the United Nations in New York City. No reference given to Isaiah, and no reference to the servant, the Messiah, the Savior, who alone can accomplish these things. But these words are inscribed outside the United Nations. They shall beat their swords in the plowshares, and their spears in the pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. That time will only come when Jesus, the righteous one, reigns on earth, when the Prince of Peace establishes his kingly throne in Jerusalem. That day is yet to come from our experience, but we are living in what Scripture calls now the last days, inaugurated by Jesus and his birth, his death, his resurrection, his ascension, and continuing on until the day that he comes. Notice it says in verse 4 of Isaiah 9, You have broken the rod of his oppressor as on the day of Midian. As on the day of Midian. Now, if you were here this morning, you can't answer this question, okay? I see that one. I'm glad you were listening, though, and if nobody gets it, I'll give you a chance. What is the reference to the day of Midian? I'll give you a couple of hints. The day of Midian, it's a day when God's people faced overwhelming odds, and yet by the sheer glory and power of the Lord, they overcame and they won the victory. What is that day of Midian? I've got more clues, but Debbie's already got her hand up.
I wasn't here this morning, so I can answer.
Okay, wait, don't answer yet, because I have a feeling you're going to get it,
all
okay?
Right, okay.
For everybody else,
that's right.
The answer rhymes with Midian. The answer rhymes with Midian. Okay, all right. Okay, I see three people that have indicated they know it. So we got Debbie, Johnny, and Dwight. Count three, you all say the answer. Okay, one, two, three.
Gideon.
All right, good job. Gideon, give him a big round of applause. That was good. All right, the day of Midian is a reference to the incredible victory that God's people had under Gideon, when God whittled the army down to just 300 men, and they had victory over Midianite hordes, the thousands of them that had gathered against God's people to make war against them. That's a reference to that. So clearly in Isaiah, remember, all of these themes are coming together. The theme of judgment, the theme of exile, the theme of a remnant returning. And the remnant, the small number, is going to have this incredible victory. So right now, we may feel like, man, God's people are so small in number. They've been whittled down so much. Well, in Christ, we're part of that faithful remnant. And we will be a part of God's plan for the future. We'll be a part of God's great victory. And so that's really, really exciting to be a part of the people of God. And even amongst the Jewish people, Romans chapter 10 is very clear in 9 through 11. God has reserved a remnant of those who believe. And I know many myself who trust in Jesus, Yeshua, as Messiah. And they are part of that faithful remnant. And so we give thanks that God always sets aside for himself a faithful remnant, and through them he will accomplish his purposes. And then we come to Isaiah 9 verse 6, that beautiful, beautiful verse. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, the government will be upon his shoulder, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. We'll talk about those four names more next Sunday. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it, to uphold it with justice, with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. We're going to talk about that more on the first Sunday of the new year. So we're looking forward to that. Actually, the last Sunday of this year, we'll talk about the zeal of the Lord accomplishing the rule and reign of Jesus Christ, which is a reality yet to come. But tonight, I want to focus on one phrase here at the beginning of 9 and verse 6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. Say that with me. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. This is God's greatest gift, his gift of love, the gift of his son. The gift of his son. I'm looking forward, even in the 2019, God permitting, watching an incredible movie clip on Communion Sunday that will paint a beautiful picture from John 3:16 of the love of the Father in sending his son for us. So that's something to look forward to the first Sunday in January. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. Our time is quickly passing, so let's consider this reality. First of all, the nature of the gift. The nature of the gift. A child, 100% human. A child is born. Jesus, the Messiah, is human. He's a man, just like us, except he had no sin. But he was tempted in every way, just as we are. He experienced all the aspects of humanity just as we do. There's one song that I loved singing when I was a kid, Away in a Manger. I used to sing it in front of the church with the other little kids, and everyone would clap for us, you know, Away in a Manger. But what's that one verse say? The little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. False. Jesus was a baby, and healthy babies cry. When Jesus ran and stumbled and fell as a little boy and he skinned his knee, he cried because it hurt. All right? He's 100% human. He experienced pain and suffering on the cross when he died in our place and on our behalf. Jesus experienced the frailty of human flesh. The God of the universe, the Word of creation, wrapped in human flesh, experiencing what it is to be human. Tempted even in every way, just as we are, much greater than we are, and yet without sin, but he is 100% human. So he knows the frailty of human flesh. a son is given. This speaks of his divinity, and we'll see this in just a moment as we look at some other passages. 100% human, 100% divine. Humanity and divinity, the nature of Christ. This is very, very important because Jesus is going to give his life for us on the cross. And as he dies for our sins, only a man, only a human representative should represent us. But if I were to give my life and die on a cross, what would that accomplish? Might be a nice example, or maybe held forth as a martyr, an example of keeping one's faith to the end, but it wouldn't do anything to save you from your sins. What's different about Jesus? What's different about Jesus is the fact that he dies in our place, on our behalf, fully human representative, but also he is God, 100% God. So only a man should die in our place, but only God could pay the price. Only a man should pay the price, only God could pay the price. And so this doctrine is very, very important. The identity of the gift, and I want to really quickly cover some scriptures, okay? So first of all, let's look at Luke chapter 1. It's very important. The angel comes to Mary. What's the angel's name? Anybody remember?
Gabriel.
The angel Gabriel. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. They had been promised to be married, but they had not yet come together in marriage. They were faithful, and they set a good example for all of us in not coming together sexually until the marriage is complete. Mary and Joseph kept their vows. They were pure. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her, the angel did, and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at this saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name
Jesus.
He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Who's the identity of the person in Isaiah 9, verses 6 and 7? Well, it's very clear from what the angel Gabriel says to Mary that that promised child and son that is given is Jesus, who will be born of the Virgin Mary. And Mary said to the angel, what anybody in her position would say. She's probably about 14 years old. She's betrothed to Joseph. She's remained pure. She's kept her vow to him. "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God." You see there, again, reference, I believe, confirming the identity of the promised one in Isaiah 9 and verse 6. To us a child is born, to us a son is given. A child to be born will be called the Son of God. "And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Nothing is impossible with God. And I love Mary's response. You know, again, she's probably only just a teenager. Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. An angel also appears to Joseph in a dream. Says, "Don't be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. The child betrothed, the child within her is given by the Holy Spirit. And you shall call his name Jesus, because he's going to save his people from their sins. And he is Emmanuel. He is God with us." And Joseph obediently does just that. You know, Joseph's a hero of the story, just like Mary is a hero of the story. Let's give Joseph his just due, right? I think I just heard today on the radio, I believe it was John MacArthur or some other radio preacher who was saying that just as God carefully selected Mary for this great honor, so God also carefully selected Joseph for this great honor. I mean, the God of the universe, the Father in heaven, is not going to entrust his son to a bad father, but to a good father. Joseph is a good father. He's a provider. He's a hard worker. He's a carpenter. That's Joseph. Look over at Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, as the apostle writes of this event. He speaks of it in terms of the fullness of time. Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. The identity of the gift is confirmed by the angels as they proclaim it to the shepherds. They even give them a sign. Another quiz question for you. Wake up now. What is the sign that the angels give as to which is the right child? You're going to go to Bethlehem, the city of David, and this will be a sign for you. You'll find a baby
in a manger.
Wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger. That's the sign confirming which is the right newborn child to worship. Notice it says, for unto you is born this day. This gift is to us. A child is born to us. A son is given to us. Unto you, lowly shepherds, is born this day in the city of David, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. The significance of the gift is that it is to us. It is for us. Sin separates us from God. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death, eternal separation from God. If we die in a state of separation from God, there's no going back. There's no changing that reality. It is fixed forever. Man is destined to die once, the scripture says, and after that to face judgment. There's no second chances. But the good news is that while the wages of sin is death, the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, the demonstration of God's great love. In 2 Corinthians 5, on Wednesday nights, we've been learning about the substitutionary atonement, how Jesus died in our place on our behalf. And Mark back there, give me a thumbs up. He remembers what we've been talking about. Yes, we've been talking about that on Wednesday nights. And 2 Corinthians 5, and verse 21 is so beautiful. It says that he who knew no sin became sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Isn't that amazing how that happens? That Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin for us. The gift is for you, it's for me. So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. It's incredible. We don't have time, but if you look at Isaiah 53, you see the substitutionary aspect of Christ, how he was in our place, and it was for us that he was stricken. It was for us that he suffered. It was our sin that he took upon him. So there's the nature of the gift, the identity of the gift, the significance of the gift, and the enjoyment of the gift. I wonder, have you opened this most incredible gift that God has given to you? How many of you, if you walked down when you were a kid, or maybe today, whatever your situation at home is, if you came down Christmas morning and there's your tree, maybe it's big, maybe it's small, I don't know, and there next to it is this present. You don't know if Santa Claus brought it. You don't know if some family member left it there. You know, you're like, wow, where did this come from? You're like, wow, awesome. This is so exciting, Santa. Would you just leave it there? You know what? It's so beautiful. I'm just going to leave it there underneath the tree. And somebody comes over a week or so later and says, hey, what's up with the big box underneath your Christmas tree? Oh, isn't that beautiful? I decided it's so nice. I'm just going to leave it right there. And they're going to, what would they say to you? What's wrong with you? Tear up, open it.
Yeah.
Open it. Let's see what's inside. No, I don't want to see what's inside. I'm just going to leave it there. What, do you really enjoy the gift if it stays wrapped? No. So the gift of Jesus is offered to everyone. It's an open invitation to all. Jesus says, many are called. The invitation goes out to everybody, but few are chosen. The chosen are those who answer the call, those who receive the invitation, those who come to the great banquet, those who accept the gift of salvation by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. That's the beauty of this whole thing. And so when we look at John chapter 1 and verse 12, John chapter 1, verse 12 says, to all who receive him, to all who receive Jesus, who believe in his name, he gave the right or power and authority to become children of God. We who were once enemies of God, children of God, born not of blood nor of the will of the flesh, but of the will of God, born of God. For the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John 3:16. Anybody know it? Raise your hand. Who wants to quote it? Say it. Say it.
So God for love the world, and gave his only begotten Son.
All right, somebody help him out.
Whosoever
believeth in him shall not perish, but have
eternal
life. So God loved the world so much. How much did God love the world? He gave. He gave his one and only unique Son, Jesus, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Hell canceled, heaven forever guaranteed. That's the good news of Christmas. That's the gift of Christmas. Ephesians 2 says that we are dead in our trespasses and sins, but God made us alive through Jesus Christ. I love what Ephesians 2:8 says about the gift of God. Ephesians 2, by the way, all these verses are written down in your bulletin if you want to look at them later. For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. You think you gotta work for your salvation? You think you gotta do religious things to be right with God? God says, oh, it's a gift. If I came to you with this beautiful gift and I said, hey, Debbie, here's a beautiful gift for you. And you said, oh, thank you. You know, that's so wonderful. But you know, I can't accept something for free. Here, I'm gonna pay you for it. And they say, no, it's a gift. It's because I appreciate you and I want to give you this gift. No, I'm gonna work for you, okay? Can I do some works to earn it? Because I don't like to be in anybody's debt. So I'm just gonna work for this. No, okay, pretty soon, as the giver of the gift, I'm gonna be offended, right?
Yeah.
Because this is a gift of love and I'm giving it freely, and a free gift freely given can only be freely received. But a lot of us, because of the pride in our hearts, we want to work for salvation, we want to earn it. We want to get to heaven one day and look in the mirror and say, way to go, Jason, you did it. No, when you get to heaven one day, when you get to heaven one day, you're going to say, Jesus, thank you. Yes. And anybody who's looking in the mirror saying, way to go, buddy, you did it, is not going to find themselves in heaven. They're going to find themselves somewhere else, a much worse place. It's not a result of works so that no one may boast, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So as we are regenerated by the Holy Spirit, the good works that change life will come, but it's a gift that we receive, and the outstretched arms of faith are always empty. And when you come to God with empty hands, they are empty to receive what God has for you. If you come to God with clenched fists, if you come to God with a bunch of good works and wanting to do it on your own, your hands are not open to receive what God has for you to receive. To us, a child is born, to us, a son is given. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, one and only unique Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. At Christmas, God gave his very best. And I wonder, have you received it? Have you received Jesus as your Savior? And if you have not, I pray that tonight you will. And if you have received the greatest gift of all, and you're enjoying that gift, and you're so happy at Christmas time, and all throughout the year that you have the gift of salvation, don't keep it to yourself. Share it with others. Share Jesus with others. Tell them the good news, how they can be saved. Encourage them to unwrap the gift that God has given. And we unwrap it by faith, by trusting in Jesus as our Savior and our Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord Jesus, to know you is to love you. To know you is to know the hope of heaven. It's all about relationship, not religion. It's all about the work that you have finished, not good works that we bring to the table. And so we trust in you, Jesus. And we thank you for being the gift. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving the gift, the child to us, the son to us. We are searching, seeking, and we find in Christ that which we truly are searching, that which we truly are seeking. We find in him our all in all. And we give you thanks. We give you thanks. And now if you are listening to me tonight and you have never received the gift of Christmas, I invite you to pray in your heart, just your heart talking to God's heart, to pray these words as sincerely as you know how. Dear Jesus, you are the greatest gift. I know that I have sinned and fallen short. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that you rose on the third day. Now, Jesus, come into my life. I receive you, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for you. Thank you that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed with me tonight for the first time to receive Jesus, the best, greatest gift of Christmas, I hope you'll talk to me and let me know. Or if you're a believer and you have any questions or doubts or a need of assurance, I'd be happy to pray with you after the service as well. We're going to stand and we're going to sing together a final song. And then we have a testimony, so very excited about that. Let's worship our Lord in response to his good and perfect gift.
All right. As Pastor Jason was talking about God's love, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son for you and me. And the fact is that a gift, you don't give it back. It's yours forever. And that's what this song is about. God's love is for each one of us. And we can't lose our salvation. It is a gift forever. He never lets go of us.
Oh,
Boy, it is such a wonderful promise that we are held in the good shepherd's hands, and nothing, no one can ever take us out of his hands. We are his sheep. He knows us. We are known by him. We know his voice. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Before we have the blessing, we have two important things to do. First of all, we're going to sing happy birthday to two people. It is Michael's birthday and John's birthday today. So let's sing together, shall we?
Happy birthday to you.